Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles taken for today's analysis and their page numbers in Chennai, Delhi, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping of the displayed articles are provided in the description box. And for the benefit of mobile phone viewers, the timestamping is also provided in the comment section. Now let's move on to the first news article. This news article is about the Indian form of secularism and its link with the lessons and the beliefs of Swami Vivekananda. We have highlighted here the relevant parts of the syllabus that can be linked to the analysis of this news article. The author states that the secular ideals of India have their roots in the Constitution. The author may be referring to a set of rights given under the right to freedom of religion under Part 3 of Indian Constitution. When we say set of rights under right to freedom of religion, we refer to Articles 25 to 28. See, Article 25.1 says that all persons are equally entitled to freedom of conscience and they have the right freely to profess, practice and propagate religion. But this is subjected to public order, morality and health. And Article 26 says that every religious denomination or any section shall have the right to establish and maintain institutions for the purpose of religion and charity. See, these are some of the provisions in Indian constitutions that are mentioned as fundamental rights, and these define the facets of Indian secularism. These are also the reason why the author is saying that Indian secularism respects the belief or it respects the credo of Sarva Dharma Samabhava, which means equal respect for all religions. The author says that early Hindu nationalists, they opposed this idea of equal respect for all religions. And in fact, we know that Mahatma Gandhi was one of the strongest proponents of equal respect for all religions. The author states that Nathuram Godse is one of a Hindu nationalist who opposed this idea of Mahatma Gandhi and has assassinated him. And the Hindu nationalists also saw the provision of two nations as one nation for Muslims and one nation for Hindus. And this notion has gained prominence in the present time more than any other time in the post-colonial history. As an example, the author cites the recent bifurcation of the Muslim majority state of Jammu and Kashmir into two union territories and also the removal of special status to the erstwhile state of Jammu and Kashmir. And these developments are viewed by the author as taking a path away from the Indian secularism. Now, if you see Western secularism, it focuses only on the separation of church from the state. Now, this means the church should not involve in the decision making of the state or the nation. In international context, the word state means the country or the nation. That is why whenever we study the members of a particular international organization, we call them as member states. Just as Western secularism, Indian secularism also is clear about the non-involvement of religious institutions in the decision-making of all citizens. But while ensuring that, it also gave equal respect and equal protection of all religions. And we should also know that Indian form of secularism opposes the social practices that are there because of some religious traditions in certain religions. Say for example, sati in Hinduism and the practice among some Muslim husbands declaring triple talaq leading to desertion of female spouses. Or you take for example untouchability or child marriage. And Indian secularism encourages inter-caste marriages. So therefore Indian secularism has a facet of providing room for state-supported religious reform. And Indian secularism deals not only with religious freedom of individuals but also religious freedom of minority communities. See, according to Article 29 and 30 of Indian Constitution, we can say that religious minorities have the right to exist and the right to maintain their culture and educational institutions. So these are some of the ways in which Indian secularism, how it differs from the way secularism is followed in the West and also in some of our neighboring countries. And according to the preamble of Indian Constitution, the people of India have resolved to constitute India as a secular nation with the liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith and worship. So these are some of the reasons why the author states that the secular ideals of India have their roots in the Constitution of India. Then the author talks about Swami Vivekananda and how Indian secularism has its deep spiritual connection in his beliefs. Vivekananda was a strong proponent of India as a multicultural nation that is rooted in religious tolerance and in modernity. He was known all across the world for his famous speech at the World Parliament of Religions. He called the audience of this parliament as the brothers and sisters. After this Chicago address in the World Parliament of Religions, Vivekananda established Vedanta Society in New York. See, this Vedanta Society bases its teachings on the system of Vedanta as explained by Sri Ramakrishna and Swami Vivekananda. We know that Vivekananda is a social and also a religious reformer and also a strong supporter of scientific modernization or scientific advancements. And according to him, all religions lead to same destination or same goal, and therefore all religions have to be equally respected. And in the article, the author highlights three important and novel facets of Hindu life as stressed by Swami Vivekananda. One is that Indian tradition for a long period of time believed not only in religious tolerance but also in accepting that all religions are true. If we see the Chicago address made by Swami Vivekananda, he has mentioned that we believe not only in universal toleration but also we accept all religions as true. Swami has said that Hinduism is incomplete without Buddhism and Buddhism is incomplete without Hinduism. Hinduism is incomplete without Buddhism because Buddhism has emerged as an alternate platform and it has embraced the concept of social equality. And when we say Buddhism is incomplete without Hinduism, this is because the fundamental tenets of Buddhism lie in Hinduism and this has been expanded by Gautama Buddha. Buddha has refined some of the goals of Hinduism, such as say liberation or moksha or even artha or the earning rightful money for sustenance. And Buddha has expanded these goals and has propounded Ashtangika Marga to provide inclusive and equal treatment to all sections of the society. And Vivekananda has also stated that in the banner of every religion, soon it will be written as help and not fight, assimilate and not destruct, and harmony and peace and not dissension. The word dissension, though it has the general meaning as disagreement or dissent, in this context of the news article, it takes the meaning of lack of unity, or here dissension means presence of rivalry. That means Swami has stressed that there shall not be rivalry, but harmony and peace. Swami Vivekananda has also established Ramakrishna Mission in the year 1897. And the purpose of establishment of this mission is to work for education and healthcare through schools and hospitals for the underprivileged or for the poor or for the all sections of the society. This mission was named as Ramakrishna Mission in remembrance of his famous mentor Ramakrishna Paramahansa. The author says that the reform agenda of Vivekananda had large number of supporters in America and Europe, and they came and helped him in establishing this Ramakrishna Mission. See, these are some of the efforts taken by Vivekananda with respect to cultural resurgence and also in carrying out religious reforms, and through which Vivekananda has laid strong foundations for the nationalist movement in our country. Vivekananda has emphasized that India has to trade or sell the Indian spirituality of giving equal respect to all religions to the West, and we should take in the scheme of scientific modernization from the West. The author states that Vivekananda has also strongly supported, or he was strongly behind, the idea of India's scientific modernization. He has supported India's plant physiologist and physicist in his scientific projects. And one of his American disciples has helped Bose to get patent for his scientific discoveries even in the United States. And Swami Vivekananda has also inspired Jamshedji Tata to establish Indian Institute of Science and also to establish Tata Iron and Steel Company. See, these are some of the instances that showed Vivekananda's strong support for India's scientific modernization and also the technological developments. And to uplift the conditions of Indian women, Swami has invited women leaders in foreign countries One such leader was an Irish teacher by the name Margaret Noble. She was called as Sister Nivedita by Vivekananda to serve the poor, in other words, to serve God. This is because Vivekananda has said that service to the poor is the service to God. And the Irish teacher has also opened and inaugurated a school for girls in Calcutta so as to promote their education and contribute in their upliftment. And you may note the contribution made by Sister Nivedita with respect to the contribution of persons of foreign origin with respect to upliftment of Indian women. Then the author talks about the influence of Vivekananda on the makers of modern India. His influence has made Mahatma Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru and Subhash Chandra Bose so as to challenge the two-nation theory. They opposed the two-nation theory as they stood for Hindu-Muslim unity. And the author says that Swami was an influence behind them. Vivekananda has defined religion as the service to the poor. He used the term Daridra Narayan. That means service to the poor is service to God. This philosophy has influenced Mahatma Gandhi to call the socially rejected and socially oppressed masses in India as children of God. In other words, Harijan. And the father of the nation has also stated that it is because of Swami Vivekananda's teaching, his love towards India has grown manifold. See, these are some of the ways in which the life and words of Swami Vivekananda has influenced the makers of modern India. The author says that for all the above reasons, as we have discussed with respect to the contribution and the teachings and the reforms carried out by Swami Vivekananda, the birth anniversary of Swami Vivekananda is called as the National Youth Day. It is celebrated as the National Youth Day. Every year on January 12, we celebrate it as National Youth Day. The author finally calls to remember the secular and modern spirit of Swami that has rediscovered and also has reformed India's cultural past. And he also asks us to acknowledge that the roots of Indian form of secular nationalism were in the beliefs of Swami Vivekananda. And therefore, Vivekananda is an icon of universal brotherhood and Sarvadharma Samabhava. That is equal respect for all religions. So the author calls the Swami Vivekananda as the monk who shaped Indian secularism. So we saw the contribution of Swami Vivekananda in bringing religious reforms and in asserting the universal brotherhood and his respect for all religions. And service of God is nothing but service to the poor. And how he mobilized international social activists to serve the poor and underprivileged in our country. And three important facets of Hindu life. And we also saw his support to scientific advancements and few instances of support and his influence on the makers of modern India. These are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this op-ed news article. Now let's move on to next article. This news article briefs about the air quality condition in Delhi. They are talking about two air quality monitoring mechanisms. One is National Air Quality Index or the AQI and the other one is System of Air Quality and Weather Forecasting, shortly called as SAFAR. First, let's see the National Air Quality Index. It was launched in 2014, that is October 2014, by the Ministry of Environment, Forests and Climate Change. It is said that the Air Quality Index will act as one number, one color, one description for the common man with respect to air quality. The index will transform the complex air quality data of various pollutants into a single number, and this number is called as the index value, that is air quality index. And it will also express single nomenclature. Here when we say nomenclature, we refer to the description and the single color. So that is the meaning when we say one number, one color, one description. So this will help a person to easily judge the air quality within his or her vicinity, that is the surrounding. The National Air Quality Index is released by the Central Pollution Control Board. Under the Air Quality Index, around 8 pollutants will be monitored. These are most importantly particulate matter 10, particulate matter 2.5, then nitrogen dioxide, sulfur dioxide, carbon monoxide, ozone, ammonia and lead. If you see this table, see there are 6 air quality index categories. Good, satisfactory, moderately polluted, poor, very poor and severe. And they are also assigning one color to each of these categories. If you see good category, we can see dark green color. and for severe, dark red. There are two things based on which each of these categories are decided. One is ambient concentration values of air pollutants. The other one is the health impacts. These are called as health breakpoints. The overall air quality index is calculated on a 24-hour basis, daily basis. 0 to 50 value is called as good. If you take severe, we can find values between 401 to 500. The values and their related categories are displayed here for your reference. Now let's see the possible health impacts for each category of the National Air Quality Index. If we say a category is good, it means there are minimal impacts to health. When the air quality is satisfactory, that means the sensitive people in the society, they are likely to feel slight discomfort during breathing. If it is moderate, then it can lead to discomfort in breathing for those people who are affected with lung diseases or asthma or heart diseases. And if the category is poor, then with prolonged exposure, most people will experience discomfort in breathing. And if the category is very poor, that means on prolonged exposure, the people in that area will have respiratory illness. And if the category is severe, it means even the healthy people will be affected. And those people who already have a disease will be seriously impacted by the severely worsened air quality. Now, this news article states that the people of Delhi breathed easy on 20th August. That is because it recorded an air quality index of 97. So 97 means the air quality is in the satisfactory category. News article mentions that recently the air quality has been oscillating or moderating between good category and satisfactory category with respect to Delhi. And one of the reasons suggested in the news article is because of the widespread rains. Now rains, when they come, they dissolve the air pollutants there. And that is one of the reasons why there could be a possible improvement with respect to air quality. Now let's see about the Central Pollution Control Board that releases this National Air Quality Index on daily basis. See, it is a statutory organization that is established based on a legislation. It was constituted in 1974 under Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Act of 1974. It also has been given certain powers and functions under the Air Act of 1981. Water pollution, air pollution, you related with Central Pollution Control Board. Similarly, we have Water Act of 1974 and Air Act of 1981. Now, one main function with respect to water pollution is that the CPCB has to promote the cleanliness of water streams and wells in different areas of the states. The promotion is carried out by preventing water pollution, by controlling and also by putting an end to water pollution. With respect to air, the function of CPCB is to improve the air quality by preventing, controlling and abating the air pollution in the country. In addition to its functions under Water Act, Air Act, it also provides technical services to Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, and this is based on the provisions of Environment Protection Act of 1986. And with respect to ministry, it comes under Ministry of Environment, Forests and Climate Change. Now let's see brief facts with respect to the System of Air Quality and Weather Forecasting, or in short, SAFAR. Though it monitors air quality, or though it provides weather forecasting, it was not an initiative that was introduced by Ministry of Environment, rather it was introduced by Ministry of Earth Sciences. This system was developed by Indian Institute of Tropical Meteorology in Pune, along with Indian Meteorological Department and National Center for Medium Range Weather Forecasting. It is said that this system was being implemented in collaboration with local municipal corporations and local educational institutions and government agencies in the metro cities of India, and it is here the air quality data is monitored. The system provides location-specific information on air quality in near real time, and it also forecasts air quality in advance of 1 to 3 days. And SAFAR is the first such system to provide such forecasting in India, that is to forecast air quality 1 to 3 days in advance and to provide air quality in near real time. For reporting the air quality, SAFAR takes the same air quality index parameters that we saw with respect to National Air Quality Index. And based on the values, SAFAR also releases the advisories for human health. In the news article, it is reported that Delhi's overall air quality was recorded in the satisfactory category with the lead pollutant as particulate matter 10. The lead pollutant is also called as prominent pollutant if you look into the website for National Air Quality Index. That article says that the main reason for the lead pollutant M particulate matter 10 is due to westerly winds, whose dominant contribution is coming from western part that is relatively dry and dusty. Now, when we say westerly winds here, we mean subtropical high altitude jet streams that move from Mediterranean Sea towards northwestern part of India. See, while moving from Mediterranean Sea towards India, these winds accumulate and carry dust particles that are known as particulate matter and maybe other pollutants also. And these pollutants worsen the air quality over the area of Delhi. And at the end, the news article mentions that Delhi and the surrounding areas are in the low wind regime presently. Now, this means the pollutants may not be carried away by the wind because of the low wind regime. And that means the pollutants are likely to stay in the same place. And they also expect no widespread rainfall for the next 3 days. And therefore, there can be slow deterioration or slow worsening of air quality in the coming days. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to the next article. This news article is about the National Register of Citizens and the update process in the state of Assam, and it also talks about what are the possible avenues for those whose names are not included in the final list that is to be published by the 31st August 2019. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article has been highlighted here. See, when we say National Register of Citizens, it means it's a register that contains the names of Indian citizens. This register was prepared in the year 1951 after the conduct of census of 1951. So at that time, this register was prepared based on a directive from the Ministry of Home Affairs. So this National Register of Citizens cover each and every person who was enumerated during the census of 1951. And at that time, it was kept in the offices of deputy commissioners and subdivisional officers. Later, in the early 1960s, these registers were transferred to the police authorities. But what happens presently from the year 2015 is that for only one particular state, the National Register of Citizens is being updated. And that state is the state of Assam. With respect to citizenship, we have Citizenship Act of 1955 and also Citizenship Rules of 2003. And generally, we say that the update process in the state of Assam is being carried out under the provisions of Citizenship Act of 1955 and under the provisions of Citizenship Rules of 2003. Now, if you see in Citizenship Rules, the government introduced a Rule 4 capital A. And this Rule 4 capital A deals with the special provisions as to the National Register of Indian Citizens in the state of Assam. And we know that in the state of Assam, for updating the NRC, first they invited applications from all the residents so as to update. This is because the Rule 4 capital A talks about the manner in which the NRC shall be prepared. It is clearly mentioned there, it shall be prepared by inviting applications from all the residents. And in the year 2015, the applications were received from around 3.29 crore residents. And thereafter, field verification were carried out. And the process is almost going to end if the government is to publish the National Register of Citizens updated NRC for the state of Assam by 31st August of 2019. So for the inclusion of the name, when the residents submitted applications, they also gave the details relating to each family and individual residing in the state of Assam. When the National Register of Citizens was prepared in 1951, the methodology was the details were collected by the officials by going to each and every house. And that registration in 1951 was also based on the enumeration of persons. So this update process is taking place only in the state of Assam. The update process means enlisting the names of those persons or their descendants whose names appear in any of the stipulated documents or, you know, the specified admissible documents. These documents has to be issued on or before the 24th of March 1971. So the cutoff date is 25 March 1971. Any person who have illegally entered into India on or after 25th of March 1971 has to be identified, detected and deported from India. So this update process is being carried out to include only the name of genuine Indian citizens who are original inhabitants of Assam. Therefore, this process will check the illegal immigration. It will detect and deport the illegal immigrants from the state of Assam. By identifying these persons and by deporting them, the process aims to protect the social, cultural, economic and political life of citizens in the state of Assam. So the NRC will segregate Indian citizens from those who have illegally entered Assam from neighboring countries such as Bangladesh. Initially, in 31st December 2017, a part of the draft NRC was published. That part of the draft covered around 1.9 crore applicants. And then the final draft was published on 30th July 2018. And in the final draft, it was found that around 40 lakh people were excluded and around 36 lakh of them have filed claims against the exclusion in the claims and objection process, which followed the release of final draft. Again, in June this year, the state coordinator for NRC in Assam has published one additional list of exclusion wherein it is found that another 1 lakh people were also excluded. So that's why the news article says around 41 lakh people are fearing to be not included in the final NRC that is to be published in the month end. So initially it was decided to release the final NRC for Assam, updated NRC for Assam by 31st July 2019. Recently, in July month, the Supreme Court has extended the final publication deadline to 31st August of 2019. See, on 19th August, the Home Minister, the Union Home Minister, has reviewed the NRC process along with the Chief Minister of Assam and other senior officials. After this, the Ministry of Home Affairs has released a statement. It says that there will be adequate arrangements made by the state government of Assam so that those persons whose names are excluded, they will get opportunity to appeal against their non-inclusion. So if their name is not included in the final NRC, so who is the appellate authority? So it is nothing but foreign tribunals. So if a person's name is not found in final NRC, they can appeal in foreigners tribunal. See, according to Foreigners Act of 1946, a foreigner means any person who is not a citizen of India. As per Section 3 of this Act, the central government has the power to make orders regarding the foreigners. By exercising this power, the central government has introduced the Foreigners Tribunals Order of 1964. As per this order of 1964, only the foreigners tribunals are empowered to declare a particular person as foreigner. But here we have to note one thing. If there are certain number of persons who are not filing any appeal at the foreigners tribunals after the release of final NRC within some prescribed time limit, anyhow they will also become foreigner. But as of now, the legal stand is that only the foreigners tribunal can declare a particular person as foreigner. We do not know exactly clearly what will happen if a certain number of persons do not appeal against their non-inclusion in the foreigners tribunal. The Ministry of Home Affairs is saying that just because a person's name is not included in the final list, he will not be declared as foreigner. That the affected persons will be given adequate opportunity to present their case before the foreigners tribunals. And it is also decided that the state government of Assam will make arrangements to provide legal aid to the needy people. These are the people whose names are excluded from NRC. Legal aid here could mean providing legal assistance. It could be even financial assistance for those people to fight their cases, or any legal assistance with respect to filing appeal in foreigners tribunal. So the government has stated that there will be adequate number of foreigners tribunals at various locations within the state of Assam so as to handle lakhs of appeals after the publication of NRC. Earlier they have fixed that there will be some 60 days time period so that within the 60 days those people whose names are not included will appeal. But now they have found that it is not possible for all of them to file appeal in the prescribed time limit of 60 days. They have increased it to 120 days. So that is the news. That is the recent update. This number of days may be extended and will be possibly extended in the future because it is really difficult to process the appeals of these many lakhs of people after the publication. The news article also tells that the citizenship rules will also be accordingly amended. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. In connection with National Register of Citizens, there is one more news article appearing in the first page of all editions. On 20th August, the External Affairs Minister of India has met his counterpart in Bangladesh at Dhaka. It is reported that no joint statements were issued by both ministers after the meeting. It could also mean that there is no clear agreement or clear announcement of policy with respect to certain important issues. One of the important issues is the National Register of Citizens updated register that has published by August 31. See, we are discussing the issue with respect to Bangladesh because most of the population who are in the state of Assam, who are illegally entered the state, belong to Bangladesh. Now, this is because even before the year 1971, there has been large influx of people from East Pakistan, present day Bangladesh. This has increased heavily, particularly on or after 25th March of 1971. Now, this is the day when Pakistan has launched Operation Searchlight in the present day Bangladesh. Fearing the crackdown by the Pakistan army, many people have left the present day territory of Bangladesh and have came to India. Now, this actually means if they are to be identified and if they are detected, they have to be deported back to Bangladesh. Now, that requires cooperation from the government of Bangladesh. That is why there is a visit by the External Affairs Minister of India. And the minister has expressed that the update process of National Register of Citizens in the state of Assam is an internal matter. When we say internal matter, it means that government of Bangladesh or any other nation shall not internationalize the situation and has to render support or cooperation for carrying out the deportation or the process that comes along with the publication. There is still lack of clarity what will happen with the people whose names are not included, whether they will be given temporary work permit, whether they will be given refugee status, whether they will be asked to totally leave the country, or whether they will be kept in detention camps. These issues are still not clear. These are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to next article. This news article is a data point which talks about population growth rate and the state of fertility and also the change in population with respect to few states. In the Independence Day speech, the Prime Minister has touched upon the need to control population explosion in India. Now, in this context, when we say population explosion, we mean increase in the size of population that can lead to shortage of resources or even lack of resources to meet the needs of increasing population. The Prime Minister has said that the rapidly increasing population poses various new challenges for the present generation and also for future generations. Here in the data point, the depiction shows that the growth in population, that is the population growth rate, is actually slowing after 1971. If you see here, the orange bar represents the rate of change in the growth of the population. Yes, the population is continuously growing, but the rate at which the population grows has reduced. See, from 1981 census figures, the growth rate is actually reducing. As per 2011 census, the growth rate of India's population 17.64%, but in 1981 census, the growth rate was around 24.66. So if you compare with 1981, the growth rate has decreased. Then the data point talks about total fertility rate. So when we say total fertility rate, we mean total number of children born or children likely to be born to a woman of childbearing age in her entire lifetime. Or in other words, total number of children born to a woman in her lifetime. Here you can see that the total fertility rate in the rural areas is higher than the urban areas. For rural areas, they have given the color of red, and for urban areas, it is the blue line. See, as per National Family Health Survey of 2015-16, the total fertility rate in rural areas is 2.4, and for urban areas, it is 1.8. So this is the difference with respect to the total fertility rate among rural and urban areas. One more inference we can take is that the total fertility rate for both rural and urban areas are decreasing continuously. But the TFR for rural areas is fast declining when compared to urban areas, because the change in slope of the line is steeper than the blue one for the urban areas. Now, in this graph, they are talking about replacement TRF. Now, replacement total fertility rate is the total fertility rate at which the population exactly replaces its numbers from one generation to next generation without migration. In other words, the average number of children
women in the country would need to have so that the population has to replace itself. According to the population division of UN, they are saying that the replacement level fertility or the replacement total fertility rate is 2.1 children per woman. They have given it in dotted line here. And this diagram is basically to show the difference in total fertility rate between 2007 and 2017. And as per this data, we can see the total fertility rate has significantly dropped in majority of the states, except Kerala and Tamil Nadu. And Jammu and Kashmir and Delhi have seen the largest drop in the total fertility rate. Here they have given circles of varying sizes so as to proportionately highlight the population in concerned states and union territories. Now this table is showing the increase in the population in concerned states between 2001 and 2011. We can see highest population increase happening in Bihar. The increase was around 25.42%, and the state that had the lowest increase in population is Kerala at 4.91%. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this data point news article. Now let's move on to the practice questions discussion session. Now, this question is with respect to National Air Quality Index. They have given two statements and are asking which of the above statements are correct. Now the first statement, there are six air quality index categories which are decided based on the ambient concentrations of air pollutants and their likely health impacts. See, this statement is correct. And the six categories, as we have seen during the analysis, are good, satisfactory, moderately polluted, poor, very poor, and severe. We saw that the air quality index with respect to Delhi has been oscillating so far between good and satisfactory, but now with the expectation that the rains may not be there, it could go to moderately polluted. Now the second statement, both particulate matter 2.5 and particulate matter 10 are part of the air pollutants that are measured as a part of this index. Now this statement is also correct. See, around 8 air pollutants are checked, and as we saw, they are PM10, PM2.5, NO2, SO2, carbon monoxide, ozone, ammonia and lead. Therefore, both the statements are correct. Therefore, the correct answer is option C, both 1 and 2. Now, this question is with respect to Central Pollution Control Board. They have given again two statements asking which are the statements are correct. First, it is a non-statutory body. Central Pollution Control Board is a statutory body that was constituted under Water Act of 1974. So the statement is wrong. Now the second statement, one of its principal functions is to improve the quality of air, to prevent, control and abate air pollution in India. This statement is correct. Now this is based on Air Act of 1981. So only the second statement is correct. Therefore the correct answer is option B, 2 only. Now this question is with respect to total fertility rate. There are two statements asking which of the statements are correct. First statement, total fertility rate means the total number of children born or likely to be born to women of childbearing age in her lifetime. Now this definition is correct. So the first statement becomes correct. Now the second statement, as per NFHS4 data, the TFR of India is higher in urban areas when compared to the rural areas in India. Now this statement is wrong because it is other way around. It is higher in rural areas when compared to urban areas in India. So only the first statement is correct. So the correct answer for this question is option A, 1 only. Now this question is with respect to National Register of Citizens. They have given two statements and are asking which of the above statements are correct. It contains the names of Indian citizens. Yes, the statement is correct. NRC is nothing but the register containing names of Indian citizens. So the statement is correct. Now the second statement, the update process in NRC is presently being conducted only for the state of Assam. Now this statement is also correct. The process was started in the state of Assam in 2015 based on the Supreme Court orders in 2013. So, at present, only for the state of Assam, the update process is going on. Most probably by August 31, updated NRC for the state of Assam will be released. So both the statements are correct. Therefore, the correct answer for this question is option C, both 1 and 2.
With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, click the like button, comment, share and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content on civil service exam preparation.